Jesus, it's such a gift that the God of the universe, the creator of the universe, has a message for us. Jesus, I thank you for bringing Marco today to speak to us, to speak your message to us. Lord, let our hearts be open to that. In your name, amen.
Thank you. Welcome.
Good morning, everyone. Well, for those of you who may have not been here the last time I was here, my name is Marco Salazar, and it is good to be back here in Delton, Michigan. We were just talking to a few people before service started, and one of the young ladies asked me, have you ever heard of Delton before you came here? And the answer was no, we have never heard of Delton. But we are very glad to be here. We're excited. We're honored to be here. And I just want to second the honor for the mothers today and say personally just happy Mother's Day on behalf of just me and my wife. And we called our mothers on the way here. Both of our mothers live about 3 hours, 3.5 hours away. So we won't be able to be with them, unfortunately, today. But we sent them some cards. We sent them some love this morning. And so I just wanted to take a few moments to just honor you guys as well. Quick story. And growing up, my mom would play praise and worship music, on her little radio. And I would, as a kid, I would sleep in. And as a young guy, probably like, you know, 7th, 8th grade, 9th grade, somewhere in there, I'll be honest with you, I hated it. I hated it. And who knew that I would be here one day preaching the Word of God in seminary at the same time. And so long story short, and my point of that story is that mothers, your faithfulness to God and your service to God and your heart for God, listen, it goes a long way. And don't take it for granted, because it was my mother's devotion to God that really made a difference in my life. And although I didn't really appreciate it at that time, years later I would go on to surrender my life to Christ. And so it's made a great difference in my life. So just want to honor you and appreciate you this morning. Well, going from that, we all know that words have the awesome power to whittle other people down to nothing or to build them into giants capable of great things, right? And so a word from a mother or a father makes a great difference. I remember growing up, my dad always had these high expectations for us kids in school. And in grade school, I used to get all A's. And I would love to get my report card and then take my report card back home to my father, my mom and dad, because I knew that they'd be so excited for my good grades, right? And they'd put the report card on the refrigerator, and there'd be hugs and there'd be encouragement. And so I was so excited to get my report card and take it home to mom and dad. Well, as all of you guys know, that as time goes on and as you go into higher grades, it becomes a bit more difficult to get all A's, right? And so when I got to college, my first semester of college, I took a class called meteorology. And that was literally my very first college class. And I thought meteorology would be a breeze. I mean, after all, I had watched The Weatherman growing up. I knew that when it was cloudy, it was probably going to rain. I knew that if it was sunny out, that it would probably be a warm day, right? So I figured, I'm going to take meteorology. It's going to be an easy A in college. I mean, who would have known that there was so much science involved in meteorology, okay? So I took the first class, and I'll just be honest with you. It was difficult. It was challenging. And I received a C-. Ouch. First class in college, right? So I got that report card, and I was like, oh. I was like, I cannot let my dad get this report card. And so I just prolonged it. And eventually my dad was like, semester's over now. So what'd you get? And I'm like, oh, my grades. Oh, I guess I do get those, don't I? Oh, yeah. And so I had it, I had them in an envelope already, so I pulled them out and I showed him. And I remember just his remarks. He was a bit discouraged, and I felt pretty bad because I didn't want to get a C-, obviously. And so there was always this sense that I needed to sort of perform or do well. There was a pressure to get good grades, and maybe some of you know what that's like, right? Several years later, my dad was diagnosed with cancer, and it was just a difficult time for the family and I. And I remember a specific moment where he was on the couch, and I remember him getting sicker and sicker, unfortunately. And we had a conversation as he was lying down. And I honestly talked to my father, and I said, "Dad, if you pass away, there's no way I can finish college. It's just, there's no point in me finishing school." And I remember my dad saying, "No, you've come way too far. Please don't quit." And a few months later, my dad did go on to be with Christ, and I did finish college. And it was his words in that moment that were the fuel for me to continue my education, to honestly even be here, living in Grand Rapids and going to seminary. It was his words that were the fuel for that. I remember that. That's a vivid conversation, and I'm sure many of you have had conversations just like that, because we all know that the right words at the right time, spoken by the right person, can make a world of difference. Amen? That the right words at the right time, spoken by the right person, can make all of the difference. In the Bible, there's a moment where God the Father speaks to his son Jesus. And it is a timely word. It's an encouraging word. And it makes all the difference. And it makes all the difference to his son Jesus, not only in that moment, but for the rest of his ministry. And it makes a difference for us this morning in our lives today, in our everyday lives, living, doing the things that we do, school and work. And it makes a difference for us. And so this morning we're going to be in Matthew chapter 3. So if you have a Bible this morning, go to Matthew chapter 3. I'm going to be there this morning. The name of my message is All Sons and Daughters. And so we're going to talk about what it means to be a son and a daughter, the implications of that. But in Matthew chapter 3, John the Baptist begins to proclaim the coming kingdom and Jesus as the Messiah who would usher in that kingdom. If you remember the story there, John the Baptist asked for repentance, or literally a turning away from one life to something that was brand new, that God was breaking in a whole new way, that Jesus was coming and he would usher in that kingdom. And for us to really see that kingdom, for you and for me to see that kingdom, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, that we would have to turn away from something, turn away from our thing that doesn't work, obviously, and turn to the thing that God has for us, a life in Christ, a life of righteousness that's only lived through Christ, salvation that only comes through Christ. And so John the Baptist, he's kind of a wild man, you remember that? I mean, what does he eat? Honey and locusts? I think, he's just kind of a wild man. I picture him, like this kind of caveman sort of looking guy. I don't know. And he's just, asking people to repent. And he's baptizing people. He's baptizing, honestly, Jewish people. And this is kind of a different thing that's going on, because normally the Jewish people weren't baptized. It was other people outside of the Jewish nation were baptized. They were known as proselytes, or it's just a fancy word for saying converts. These converts were baptized as a symbol that they'd be washed, cleaned, and they would come in the faith of God, and they'd convert to Judaism. But now John the Baptist is baptizing Jewish people. Those who think, "I need to be baptized? I need to be clean? I mean, why? What's going on, right?" But he's saying, "Repent. Turn away from your sin. The kingdom is near." And lo and behold, the guest of honor shows up, right? Jesus, the one who would usher in the kingdom. It's important to note that the baptism of Jesus is mentioned in all four Gospels. It's a significant event to the Gospel writers. So if you have your Bibles with you, I want you to shoot down to Matthew 3, verse 13, and we'll pick it up there. Verse 13 says this: "Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to John to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, 'I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?' But Jesus answered him, 'Let it be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness.' Then he consented." So I want you to notice just for a few moments here that John sees Jesus, and he knows that he's the Lamb of God. He knows that he's the one to take away the sins of the world. And John just thinks that it's a bit odd. He says, "Wait a second, I'm going to baptize you, aren't I? I mean, you're the one who's greater. You're the ones whose sandals I'm not worthy to tie. I should baptize you? This seems backwards, Jesus." And Jesus says, "No, no, no. This is so all righteousness can be fulfilled. And so Jesus actually gets baptized, right, by John the Baptist. It's actually pretty cool. He gets baptized, and it's Jesus identifying with sinful man. And Jesus goes under the waters, and he comes back up. But he's also identifying with the ministry of John the Baptist. He's saying, you know what, John's, I put my public stamp of approval on John. So he's really saying, John's mission and my mission, it's the same. We're on the same team. We're for the same cause. It's the kingdom of God. And so he lets everyone know that I'm on John's side, and we're on the same team. And Jesus has no reason to be cleansed, right? He has, honestly, we know that Jesus was sinless. He had no sin. So there was no reason Jesus really needed to be baptized. He didn't need any cleansing from his sin because he had no sin. But he did it anyways to identify with sinful man and to also identify with John's ministry and John's mission. Verse 16, let's keep going. And when Jesus was baptized, immediately he went up from the water, and behold, here's what happens. The heavens were opened to him. This is this epic moment. Just picture this for a few moments. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and coming to rest on him. And behold, a voice from heaven said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." And I want you to just, if you have a smartphone, you can highlight it in your smartphone. If you have a Bible, maybe highlight it, underline it, maybe just put a star near verse 17, because I'm going to build my entire message off of verse 17. Here's what God the Father says about his Son. He says this, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." In the Gospel of Luke, he gives the same account of Jesus being baptized, but apparently in the Gospel of Luke, Jesus is baptized near the end of the day when all other candidates are cared for. And the heavens open up, and it's probably this dramatic moment. I mean, the light shines down, you can imagine it. And then God speaks. Now, I think when we look at this text, when we look at this verse, we would all think to ourselves, well, that's not a big deal. God speaks. I mean, God speaks in the Old Testament. God, you know, speaks to our hearts now, and we're led by the Spirit, and what? We take that for granted. But this is really interesting, because in the life and the ministry of Jesus, God the Father speaks only three times. Only three times. Now, sure, he speaks in Acts. Remember with the account with Paul, and where Saul at that time, Saul gets knocked off his horse. Remember who talks to him? It's Christ himself. It's the living God, and he talks. But I'm talking about in the ministry, in the life of Jesus Christ, that God the Father speaks audibly three times. And he speaks three times for his Son Jesus, but not just his Son Jesus, but for others who are around to hear him. So here's what I want to do. If you have, you can kind of keep your finger there, whatever. I want to take you to those three times. We're going to dissect those three different occurrences where God speaks, and we're just going to talk about them, and then we're going to talk about the significance of God speaking at this moment. So here's what we're going to do. Go to Matthew 17. Here's another time when God speaks. So we've already seen it right here, Matthew chapter 3. Now, Matthew 17, go there. Most of you know this as a transfiguration. You're probably very familiar with this passage of Scripture. And if you're in Matthew 17, you can just start off right in verse 1. I'm going to read that for you, actually. We'll talk about it for a few moments. Verse number 1. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter, James, and John, and his brothers, and led him up a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. Can you imagine being there? I remember what that would look like. Probably amazing, right? Verse number 3, and behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. So out of just nowhere, Moses and Elijah appear, they're having this conversation with Jesus, and you can imagine what they're thinking about and how they reacted, like, right? I mean, Moses and Elijah, like these, you know, these great figures of the Old Testament, just come in, just show up randomly and decide to have a conversation with Jesus, right? This is insane. Verse number 4, And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He was still speaking when, behold. You see that often in the New Testament. The gospel writers would often use that word, behold. It's literally just a way, as a means to get our attention. Behold, look, right? Pay notice. This is significant. When behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, this is going to sound familiar to you, this is my beloved son, with whom I am well pleased. I want you to notice what's tacked on at the end, though. Listen to him, right? Listen to him. Moses represents the law right here. Elijah represents the prophets. Okay? Moses, Elijah. Moses and Elijah being there is really significant because all the law and prophets, guess what they point to? If you don't know, the answer is always Jesus, okay? Moses and Elijah, the law and the prophets all point to Jesus Christ. And the law and the prophets are all fulfilled in Christ. So Jesus has been doing his ministry for a while, and God is still pleased, apparently. And now he adds the phrase, listen to him. Again, another public stamp of approval. Seems to be a positive thing, right? All right, keep your fingers there, or you don't have to, actually. We'll go to another gospel. Let's go to John. John chapter 12. I know I'm taking you all over the place this morning, but I have a point, I promise, okay? John chapter 12. Stay with me. If you're awake, say amen. Okay, you're awake. Praise God. Because if you're falling asleep, I'll probably fall asleep, and that'll just be really awkward for all of us. All right, John chapter 12, I want you to shoot down to verse 28. The times, three different occurrences when God the Father speaks, right? Remember this? We've seen it in Matthew 3, we've seen it in Matthew 17. Now John chapter 12, go to verse 28. This is good. This is Jesus predicting his death, and this is what he prays. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. It's a little different this time. Here's what God says. God the Father says, I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. 29. And the crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. In other words, they weren't sure what was going on. It was like a sound of thunder to them. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, this voice was for your benefit, not mine. So here we see it again. God's voice speaks audibly, and the crowds hear it. And Jesus basically says, this was more for your benefit than mine, right? And this is close to the near the end of Jesus' ministry. Again, God the Father speaks. And Jesus prays, Father, glorify your name. And Jesus, and God the Father says, well, I have glorified it. You know what he means by that? He's basically saying, Son, your life has glorified me. You've done well. Your life has brought me glory. And son, your death on the cross and your resurrection, because he says, I will continue to glorify, or I will glorify in the future. In other words, God the Father is saying, your death, your resurrection will glorify me. And so here we see it again near the end of Jesus' ministry as he predicts his death. That God is well pleased, and that it does appear in front of many, many people. Many people are there. It's not just Jesus. And they all hear it. It's this thundering. It's this public stamp of approval. God affirms his son three times, right? We've seen that. Once at the beginning of his ministry. Once sort of somewhere in the middle of his ministry. And then what we just read. One near the end of his ministry, near his death. You see that? It happens three times. But here's what I want to do. I want us to go back to Matthew 3, and we're going to talk about that now. Matthew chapter 3, he affirms Christ his son, and he says, I am well pleased. And I want you to think about this. The interesting thing that about this verse is that it comes at a time when Jesus had not yet begun his public ministry. At that point in Matthew's gospel, Jesus hasn't performed any miracles, right? I mean, he hasn't done anything. At that point in Jesus' ministry, Jesus hasn't done any miracles. He hasn't fed the thousands, the 5,000 with just a few fish and just a few loaves. At that time, Jesus hadn't healed anyone. He hadn't caused the lame to walk, and he hadn't healed the sick, and those perhaps who were blind. At this point in Jesus' ministry, he hasn't sat on a mountain with crowds all over him and expounded on these truths that we know as the Sermon of the Mount and the Beatitudes. And Jesus hadn't done that yet, though. At this moment, Jesus hadn't calmed the storms and had the disciples say to him, or say out loud, "Look, even the winds seem to obey this guy." At this point, Jesus hadn't done anything super significant. And what does God the Father say? He says, "This is my son, my beloved son, the one I love, right? In him, I am well pleased." At this point in Jesus' ministry, no one's even been amazed by his teachings. You remember what happens after the Sermon on the Mount where he teaches after a while? The people say, "Man, this guy speaks with authority." We recognize that he's not like the scribes. There's something different about Jesus. But at this point, this hadn't even happened yet, right? It's one thing to be pleased with Jesus after all of these things, after all those things that I just mentioned. It would be one thing to be pleased with Jesus after all of that. But I want you to see this morning, church, that God the Father was pleased with his son before any of those happened. It's one thing for God. Can you imagine God sort of, you know, in the heavens with the angels overlooking, and God's, you know, talking to the angels, and they're looking down at Jesus, and God the Father is speaking and saying, "Did you see my son?" Oh man. That part where he into the mud and he spit in and he put it in the guy's eyes and he healed him. Oh, brilliant. Oh, good job, son. I like that one. Keep it up. Yeah, baby. God the Father, maybe he, perhaps, you know, in heaven, looking at Jesus, walking on water. Ho, ho, wow. I didn't even think of that one. What? Did you see that? What do you think about that? Isn't that cool? I mean, he learned everything from me, but, I mean, wow. Hey, I love you. Keep it up. I love that water walking trick. Love it, right? That's one thing for God the Father to be pleased with Jesus doing all of those things, those miraculous things. "Hey, did you notice my son? That's that thing called the Sermon on the Mount. By the way, people will be reading about that for thousands of years after," right? And the angels be like, "Wow, whoa, great sermon, son. Great sermon," right? People will talk about that for thousands of years later. No, it's one thing for Jesus to do that or for God the Father to speak well of his son after all that. But this is not the point. In Matthew chapter 3, Jesus hasn't done any of that. He hasn't done any sort of accomplishments. He just is his son. That's it. And he says to him, "I'm well pleased. And I love you." Wow. I want you to think about this for a few moments. When was the last time that you complimented someone, a friend, son or daughter, when was the last time you complimented someone for just breathing? I didn't see any of your hands go up, so I'm assuming. It's not like any of us say, "Hey, I just want to say, great job breathing today. Awesome, man. You're doing a great job walking today." I mean, no. I mean, our world is not wired like that, is it? Of course it's not. You know what our world is wired to say? And to give compliments? We give compliments and we give encouragement when what? When people do something. "Hey, I just want to say you did a great job." I mean, we encouraged some of the saints here this morning who are serving, who are cleaning the church, who are secretaries and doing the work of God here in the local church. And we encouraged them, not because they were breathing though. I mean, that would be nice too. We could do that. But because apparently, from what I heard Paul say, they were doing a great job cleaning the church. They'd been faithful. And the new people that came up here were so incredibly just willing to serve God in that manner. And so we were encouraging them because they had done something, right? We applauded. We even prayed for them because they had done something significant in our eyes, right? And that's the way the world works. We give encouragement. We compliment when someone does something. Often we do it when someone does something for us. I mean, we do it more so than that. But we always do it when people give or when people do something that we think is just a bit significant. But in Matthew 3, this is not the case. Before Jesus had done any of those things, the Bible reads that God calls Jesus his beloved son. He's well pleased with him. God puts his public stamp of approval on Jesus right before Jesus begins his ministry, God says aloud for anyone to hear who is present, "I'm well pleased with my son." Jesus knows he's well loved by the Father. And so does anyone else who happens to be there in that moment. Matthew chapter 4, if you remember the story, Jesus is led by the Spirit into the wilderness or into the desert to be tempted by the tempter or the devil. And the devil comes up to him, and the first question that he asks for Jesus is, "If you are the Son of God." And what does he do? He attacks his identity. "If indeed you are the Son of God." You know what Jesus doesn't do or doesn't have to do? Jesus doesn't have to wonder. Jesus doesn't have to think about it. You know, I'm not sure anymore. Why? Because he already knows, right? Just right before that, Jesus is baptized. And his Father speaks over him. And this morning, church, I would say the same of all of us in Christ. Did you know that the same is true for you and for me? That if you're in Christ, if you stop relying on your own works, on your own behavior to earn God's blessing, and if you've begun to trust in God's choice to bring salvation through Jesus, then God is well pleased with you. God is pleased with you right now. He calls you his beloved son. He calls you his beloved daughter. And I think all of us get this really, really well when we're first saved, and when we first have this relationship with Christ and we give our lives to Christ. We know this very well. It's a breath of fresh air for all of us. Oh my gosh, I can't believe that God would give his only son for me. And oh, I'm so wretched, and I've done so many mistakes, and there's so many things I'm not proud of. And gosh, I've lived this life, and I'm just ashamed of the things I used to do. And oh man, I can't believe you would come to save me of my sins. And our response usually is, "Gosh, God, you have my life, and you have my heart. And God, I'll serve you. I'll walk with you every day. And God, I'm on that journey with you now. I follow your son Jesus. I'm committed." And I think in the beginning, when we first have a relationship with Jesus, when we first open our hearts to him, and God comes with his grace and he overwhelms us, that we're so, that it's easy to grasp a hold of this truth. But I think that it becomes much more difficult years after we've been walking with Christ. And it's easy in the beginning, but I think it gets harder at years later. Here's what I mean. When's the last time you thought to yourself you were discouraged because you just thought, yeah, you just weren't doing enough for God? When's the last time you had a guilt trip because you just could not keep to that stinking Bible reading plan? When was the last time you felt guilty and condemned because you didn't pray 7 hours a day like the guy at work says he prays? When was the last time you felt like you had to perform for God, like you were some sort of circus monkey? And if you didn't perform a certain way, if you didn't do enough things for God, if you didn't say enough prayers, if you didn't read enough Bible verses, that God somehow, that God was just not pleased with you? When was the last time you've done that? Honestly, I think many of you probably have, and I have myself many times. When was the last time you thought to yourself, "I'm just not, God cannot be pleased with me. I should have entered the ministry. I should be a pastor. I should be a missionary. But instead, I'm just doing this. I guess I'm just wee little me. You know, I don't have much part in the kingdom of God." But when was the last time you gave yourself that guilt trip and told yourself, "God cannot be pleased with me because I did not become a pastor. I didn't go to seminary. I didn't join the mission field. I wasn't an evangelist," or whatever it might be. When the opposite actually is true, that right now, you sitting here, worshiping with me, because we're worshiping together, we're hearing the proclamation of God's word, that God is pleased with you right now. Not a future version of you, but you right now. And I know some of you are going to fight me on, no, 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 well, I've got to just do this first. And when I do this, then I know he'll be pleased with me. Praise God. I'm so excited that you realize the areas in your life where you need to improve and where you're convicted. That's the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. But you know what? God's not waiting for that to happen. God's saying in Christ that he's well pleased with you. That you are his beloved son. That you are his beloved daughter. And just like Jesus, before Jesus had done anything spectacular, that God's pleased with you right now. And that you don't have to perform for God. You're not a circus monkey. You are a son. You are a daughter of the most living, the living God. And too easy, it becomes more difficult the longer that we walk with Christ. The more difficult this truth becomes for us to grasp. Too often we get locked into a mode of religion instead of the gospel. I want to take you through a few things that marks religion and marks the gospel, and then we'll wrap it up and we'll pray together. Paul, I got some slides if you will go there. The first one is on religion, if you can find that. All right, let's look at this first one. Religion, because the world is used to this sort of mindset. Religion just says, I obey, therefore I'm accepted. Think about this for just a few moments. Because the fact I obey, because I'm a good little boy, a good little girl, because I'm a good Christian, because I've read all of the New Testament, you know, over the last 40 days, then I'm accepted by God because I've done those things already. Because I pray every morning, every mid-afternoon, and every late afternoon with my family. Because I tuck my kids in and I pray with them, then God accepts me. I obey, therefore I'm accepted. That's the way religion thinks. But it's different with the gospel. Paul, will you go to the next one? Here's what the gospel says. The gospel says, I'm accepted, therefore I obey. I'm accepted, therefore I obey. That God is pleased with me right now because God is lavishing his love and his grace on me. You know what I'm free to do? I'm free to obey God. I'm free to follow him. I'm free to walk with him. Man, that's incredible, right? I'm accepted by Christ, even with my dirty past and all the things that I've done wrong. Man, that frees me up for a life of devotion to God. Wow. Next one. Religion. I obey in order to get things from God. I obey in order to get things from God. I'm just doing my due diligence. I'm doing my thing. If I do my thing, then God, you've got to do your thing, and I'm going to do my thing, and I'm going to be obedient. You're going to give me this because I do my part. My part, then your part. That's not how grace works. Gospel. I obey God to get God. What? To delight in him and to resemble him. I obey God not to get something from him, but to actually get him. Him. My life with God. And the more that I have life with God, guess what happens? The more I resemble him. And guess what happens? The more I turn away from a life of sin. The more I come to the heart of God. The more I devote to God. The more I read the Bible. The more I pray. The more I minister to my coworkers. The more I love my family. Next one, religion. My prayer is largely petition, and it increases when I'm in need. I can relate to that one. My purpose of prayer is to control my environment. This is what religion says. I pray to sort of make things work out, to control my environment. And when I go to God, I just ask, give me. I have this laundry list. It's like a scroll, just rolls out. And I've got this, list of things that I'm asking God. God, do this. God, do this. God, do this. God, do this. Yeah, and did you forget? No, God, don't forget number 27. I need that especially by next Friday. Make it happen. So my prayer life is largely this petition. I see God as this, giant being that will just give me things. And I'm, okay, God, bring it on. Let's do this, right? But I think prayer changes when we understand grace, when we understand that we're in Christ, and then when we understand that we're accepted by God, that grace changes everything. Look what happens with the gospel. My prayer life consists of generous praise. I pray for fellowship with God. So when I pray, it's not just God, give me, but it's God, thank you. God, I love you. God, you've been so good to me this week. God, your mercy and your grace, God, I don't deserve it. God, you have lavished your love on me, a sinner. God, I devote my life to you. God, I'm here to just be with you. God, I just want to be with you right now. Oh, I don't know. I can't remember what I was praying for, but God, who cares about that? But God, I'm here with you. Speak, God, to me. Your fellowship with God. Our prayers are not just reduced to petitions that we think God will just give us things. But no, we want God for fellowship. And we praise him in that time of prayer. I think I've got, a couple more left? Religion. When life goes bad, I blame God. Because anyone who is good, notice that word, good, deserves a comfortable life. You know what religious people do? Religious people say, God, I've done this for you. God, I've done this for you. And this is how you repay me? That's the mindset of a religious person. You owe me when God owes us nothing. You owe me. I've done this. I've read my Bible. I've done da-da-da-da-da. And we list all our things. And therefore, God owes us something. And we blame God when life gets tough. But you notice the word good? Because anyone who is good deserves a comfortable life. You know what's wrong with that problem? You know what's wrong with that word? None of us are good, right? The scriptures say that we've all fallen short. And guess what happens to us anyways? God still comes to us through his Son. He gives us grace. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Go to the gospel. When circumstances in my life go wrong, I struggle. Sure, we can all struggle. That's normal. But I know all my punishment fell on Jesus. And while God may allow for this for my training, he will exercise his fatherly love within my trial. That even though we go through difficult times, and sure we struggle with them, it's normal. It's okay to struggle with difficult times. It's certainly okay. We know that God will use it. That God, despite our troubles, will still lavish his love on us. That God hasn't forsaken us. That God hasn't left us. He hasn't abandoned us. That God still loves us. He's pleased with us. And I have one more. Oh, I don't. Well, you can leave it up there. Leave that scripture up there. We'll go to that in a few minutes. Today, some of you need to rest in the fact that in Christ, that God is pleased with you. He's pleased with you now, right now. Some of you have been beating yourself up far too long. You've been listening to the lies of the devil, of the enemy of your soul. And this morning, I want you to hear these words. This is my son. Or how about this? We can add this in there. This is my daughter, whom I love, and I am well pleased. This is my son, whom I love, and I am well pleased. 1 John 3:1, you see it up on the screen here. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are, sons and daughters. For some of you in here, you may have never heard these words growing up. Do me a favor, just as we wrap up, as we close service today, would you just close your eyes with me? I'm going to pray with you in a few moments here. Before I pray, I want to read this verse one more time to you, just a few times, and I want you to rest in that this morning. This is my son. This is my daughter, whom I love, and I am well pleased. This is my son, whom I love, and with whom I am well pleased. This is my son, my love, and I am well pleased. And in Christ, God is well pleased with you. Let's pray this morning together. Heavenly Father, it's so easy to get involved into a life of religion instead of a life of grace in the gospel. God, far too often it's easy to just beat ourselves up because we compare ourselves to other people who It seems like they do more godly things than we do. It seems like they have their life just a bit more together than we do. It seems like they have more of a devoted, committed life, God. So we compare, God, with other people. We compare with what they have, what we have, what they do, what we do, Lord. But God, this morning, would you speak to your people this morning, God, and would you say that we are sons and daughters because of Christ, not because of our own works or the things that we do, God, because of you and the work of your Son. The Gospels are not about what we do, but it's about what he's done for us. And so, God, this morning I pray that we would see your Son lifted high and that you would change our hearts and that you would allow us to see that we are sons and daughters, that you are well pleased with us, God. God, as we walk with you, God, the things that we want to change, we know that you will continue to change those in our hearts and in our lives, God. But God, right now, we want to sit in the fact, we want to rest in the place that says that we are sons, we're daughters, we are loved, God. God, and you are pleased with us, Lord. God, we rest in that today, Lord. Thank you for this church and the work that you do here, Lord. We ask you that you seal it in our hearts, God, and that we leave changed and transformed. It's in your Son's holy name we pray. Amen.